Hello students, welcome to this class. In this class, we will be dealing with an important topic under perception, that is depth perception. And we will be seeing how depth perception occurs with the help of visual, monocular and binocular cues. Now first, let us begin with what perception is. Perception involves giving meaning to our sensations. Of course, as we know, we receive a large amount of sensations from different sense organs in our body almost on a continuous basis. But the duty of meaningfully interpreting this sensation belongs to the brain, and it is the organization process in the brain of these many sensations that leads to a perception of meaning or a meaningful understanding of the phenomena around us. For instance, when we look at a rose, our sensations consist of color, certain shades and certain shapes. But when we actually perceive it with the meaning our brain organizes and puts into the experience, we do not perceive a mixture of color or shapes or shades. We perceive a flower which we can identify as a rose. Thus, we give meaning to our sensations. Now, our perception of any kind of environmental phenomena includes three aspects. The first is height, the second is width, and the third is distance or depth. Now, it was a puzzle to many psychologists and physiologists over the century as to how we could perceive depth. As we know, vision happens when light rays enter the eye through the cornea and passing through the lens fall on the retina. Now, an important fact is that our retina is two-dimensional, and it is the concept of distance or depth in our perception that makes our view of the world three-dimensional. So, what was puzzling for the psychologists was that how can we see three-dimensional figures when the light rays and the image falls on a two-dimensional or a flat retina? And over the years, a number of researches were conducted to analyze this point of view. And finally, it was understood that part of our depth perception is caused due to the presence of visual monocular cues or clues which are generated by vision from a single eye or from one eye. And part of our depth perception happens due to visual binocular cues or the kind of visual experience we have when we use both our eyes to look at any particular object. And today in this lesson, we will be trying to deal in detail as to what the various visual monocular cues or the cues depending upon one eye and the visual binocular cues or cues depending upon both the eyes are. And to understand this is a very interesting phenomenon, because now we will understand how a two-dimensional world becomes three-dimensional for us. And the importance of these cues can be understood from the very fact as to how odd and how difficult our perception of the world would be if we were to see only two-dimensional images like we see on a television screen, rather than three-dimensional images and the entire perspective of a situation. Now, first we come to visual monocular cues. Now, monocular cues of vision are the kind of cues that many a times painters use to give a three-dimensional effect to a painting which is two-dimensional, as we know. Now, there are certain visual monocular cues we will be discussing today. The first cue is the cue of size. Now, the larger the image of an object on the retina, the larger we perceive it as. Hence, in an environment, if we perceive an object as larger, we feel that it is closer to us. Now, have a look at the picture. We see two people, person A and person B. Which of these people do you think is closer to you? If your answer is person B, then this is because of the operation of the visual monocular cue of size. Because person B, as you can see in the picture, has a larger size as compared to person A. And so we conclude that person A must be closer to us as compared to person B. A second monocular cue we will be learning today is that of the linear perspective. The linear perspective says that as the distance of an object or an image increases from our retina, parallel lines tend to converge, and the distance between two images tends to reduce as it moves farther away from our eyes. Have a look at this picture of a railroad track and imagine yourself that you are standing between the tracks. You can see that where you stand, the railroad tracks appear as two different tracks. But when you look forward, you will almost feel that those tracks are coming together and merging together, becoming one. And the more the merger, the more farther you feel the railroad tracks are. And this gives us a perception of distance. When things converge together, you can see that things are quite distant from you. And whatever you are seeing is placed at a lot of depth or distance. And painters often converge parallel lines together so as to show depth or distance in a painting. A third monocular cue is clearness or the atmospheric perspective. You must have seen in day-to-day life that the clearer an object is, the more you feel that the object is closer to you. This is because when an object becomes more distant from us or from our eyes, then there is a possibility of many other things, say fog, dust, haze, and many other things to come in between our vision and the object. And hence, the level of clarity will decrease. Hence, if we see an object as less clear than the other, as you can see, object C is less clear than object D. If we see it in this way, we feel that, of course, object C is farther away from us as compared to object D. And even an object at the same distance, say you are looking at a mountain from your balcony, on a very foggy day, you will feel that the mountain is farther away from you than where it actually is. This is because fog and haze come in between your vision and reduce the clarity of your vision. So you feel the mountain is farther away. Suppose on a clear day, on a day of bright sunlight, you will fear that, oh yes, the mountain is very near to us. This is because the clarity in your vision has increased. Thus, we can see that clearness or the atmospheric perspective is a major factor that gives us an idea about depth and distance. Now, the fourth visual monocular cue that we are going to study today is the cue of interposition or overlap. Have a look at the picture of these two bottles. Does bottle X appear closer to you, or does bottle Y appear closer to you? Of course, for all of us, bottle X appears closer. Now, why is this? This is because of the visual cue or the visual monocular cue of overlap or interposition. X is placed in front of Y in such a way that the bottle X partly obstructs the view of bottle Y. And hence we feel that the bottle X is positioned or placed in front of bottle Y because we have a full view of X and we do not have a full view of Y, which is hidden behind X. And hence it is hidden and it is behind X. It is more distant from us as compared to X. This visual monocular cue of interposition is often very frequently used by painters to show depth or distance where the farther objects are partly hidden behind or partly hidden by objects that are nearer to us. Now, another visual monocular cue we will be dealing with is shadows. Now, shadows form a very important element of our perception. The darker the shadows, the farther is the object. And the lighter the shadows, the closer we feel the objects are. Have a look at this picture of the Quonset huts. As usual, we can see a number of huts. Now come to the next picture, picture 2, where the picture is totally inverted. What do you see? Do you see the huts anymore? No, probably if you had seen the picture in this way, you would have seen the Quonset huts as towers. These kind of images triggered a lot of curiosity among psychologists as to why such stark differences in perception were happening just when an image was inverted. This is because we are always used or accustomed to light coming from above. just the way sunlight comes from above. And hence, shadows to us always fall on the ground or fall on the surface. And hence, the shadows of the Quonset huts you can see in the image, which is not inverted, became the black tops of the towers when the image was inverted, because we could not imagine a shadow on the top of a building or on the top of a tower. And hence, the Quonset huts began to be seen as towers with black roofs. Another important visual monocular cue is the cue of texture or gradient. Now, gradient or texture can be seen as a continuous change in the pattern of anything. We can see gradients in our floor tiles, we can see gradients even on the walls or even among the soil or any kind of surface, gradients can be seen. Now, have a look at this picture and you will see how this change in gradients is coming. In the part which is closer to you, you can have a clear idea of what the texture or the gradient is. You can see the tiles and you can see the stones very clearly. But as you look at the farther end of the image becomes more hazy. The fine details cannot be seen. And hence, we feel that this part of the image is quite farther away from us or quite distant as compared to the earlier part of the image. Thus, texture or gradient gives us an important monocular cue regarding distance. The clearer the texture or distance, the clearer the texture or gradient, the closer the object is. And the more hazy or more unclear the texture is, or the more we cannot see the fine details, the more distant the texture or gradient is. Painters often use the texture gradient to a large extent, trying to give a three-dimensional view in their paintings. For instance, for those objects they want to show as closer, they may involve a great degree of fine detail, whereas for those objects they want to show as farther, they may make them more hazy and more unclear, thus using the texture gradient. Now we come to yet another visual monocular cue, that is the cue of movement or the motion parallax. Now if you fix your eye on a point and then turn your head from side to side, you will see that images in front of the fixation point tend to move in a direction opposite to that of your head, whereas images beyond the fixation point or images that are farther away tend to move in the same direction as the direction of your head. Now, all of us may have experienced this while traveling by a train. When you travel by a train, you see that nearer objects such as the railroad tracks or the trees tend to move extremely fast in a direction opposite to the direction in which you are moving. Now, next time you are in a train, try to focus on the distant objects, the distant hills or the distant trees. You will see that unlike the trees or objects closer to you, they will not move in the opposite direction. They will continue to move in the direction in which you are moving. Now, this concept was understood and labeled by psychologists as the motion parallax. According to this feature, objects closer to you move in an opposite direction as compared to the movement of your head, whereas objects farther to you move in the same direction as the movement of your head. And since we often move our heads to assess distance and direction, this principle is very effective for us in determining as to what kind of distance the particular object or person is at from us. Now, another visual monocular cue is the cue of height or aerial perspective. Now, below the horizon, objects lower down are seen as closer, whereas when we raise our vision above the horizon, objects which are higher up are seen as closer. And this is sometimes seen when we see the full moon in the sky. The full moon, as it rises and moves farther into the sky, we see it as closer, because it is moving farther up in the horizon. Now, the last visual monocular cue we will be seeing is the cue of accommodation. Now, depending upon the distance of an object from the eye, the muscles of the eye and the lens have to adjust themselves so that the image of the object falls exactly on the retina. If the object is very close to you, then the lens becomes rounder with the help of the muscles controlling the lens, that is the ciliary muscles, so that the image of the object falls exactly on the retina. Say for example, the object is farther away, then the lens becomes flatter with the help of the ciliary muscles, so that the light rays coming from a distance fall exactly on the retina and the image is formed also exactly on the retina. Now, this principle of accommodation which the eyes follow can be an important cue for visual perception of depth. This is because when an object is closer to us, our eyes tend to converge and focus, and as the lens and the muscles surrounding them become rounder, there is a sense of pressure on the eyes which tells us that the object is very close to us. On the other hand, when we are looking at a distant object, the muscles of the eyes relax so as to make the lens flatter and we experience a lesser degree of pressure. And hence, the greater the degree of pressure we feel as our eyes converge together, the closer is the object to our eyes. Now that we have seen the visual monocular cues for depth perception, we will go on to see what are the visual binocular cues of depth perception, or the cues which involve the use of both our eyes. Now, even if we have a single eye, or if people are blind in one eye, they are able to have a fairly good amount of depth perception because they will be aided by a good variety of visual monocular cues. But as you know, most of us see the world with both the eyes, and hence we can also enjoy a new set of cues, that is binocular cues, which again enriches our vision and helps us to see better three-dimensional images of the world around us. Now, what are these visual binocular cues? The visual binocular cues arise from the very fact that we have two eyes and that the two eyes are set separate and the two eyes are set at a level of separation or are set apart. That is, there is a distance of around 65 millimeters or around 2.5 inches between the positioning of both our eyes. And hence, the kind of images that both our eyes get are slightly disparate or slightly different from the other. The image of the same object that falls on our left eye is slightly different from the image of the same object that falls on our right eye. Now, this difference between the two images is interpreted by the brain as a clue for determining the distance of the object from the eye. Now, this clue is used by the brain depending upon another major factor, that is convergence. As you know, the fovea is that portion of the retina where the cones or the mechanisms or cells responsible for color vision are most focused. And hence, the fovea is also the place where the greatest degree of visual acuity or visual detail can be obtained. And hence, when both our eyes look at an object, the image of the object mainly falls on the fovea because we want to have a clear knowledge of the object. And the images formed by the foveas of both the eyes are slightly different from each other. So, do we see two different objects in two different forms or qualities? No. The two images of the two foveas are fused together or integrated together, and this process happens within the human brain. And the human brain integrates these two images or converges these two images to give us a single image. And this interpretation process is one means by which we get an idea of the distance at which the object is. The more the brain has to work to fuse the objects together, the more closer the objects are or the more different the images on the retina. Now, when an object is closer to us, say 40 to 50 feet, the process of convergence starts because, as I have mentioned, the closer the object, the more different the images on the two retinas. And a number of eye muscles are involved in the process of convergence along with the brain. The greater the activity or strain on the eye muscles and the greater the activity of the brain to put two images together, the lesser is the distance of the object from the eye. Whereas if the object is at a distance, there is a greater similarity in the two images formed in the retina, and hence both our eye muscles as well as our brain have to exert less on the interpretation or unification of these two images. Finally, if an object is too close to our eyes, try this by keeping your textbook very close to your eyes, you can't read anything. This is because the eye also and the brain has its limits. If an object comes too close to the eyes, the images on the retina of the two eyes are so different that any kind of meaningful unification or convergence of the images becomes extremely difficult. So, as we have seen in this lesson, depth perception or the perception of distance, which involves a three-dimensional view of the world, or which gives us a real view of the world as it is, depends upon cues provided by the functioning of a single eye and cues provided by the functioning of both the eyes together. We have seen in detail a number of visual monocular cues which are used both by us and other artists to show depth and distance both in our real world as well as in paintings. We have also seen the functioning of visual binocular cues, which happen because we have two eyes and these two eyes are set separately from each other. Thus, we can see how the physiological system and brain interpretation works in an extremely beautiful and extremely harmonized fashion to give us a complete view of the world and perceive it, and allows us to perceive the world in all its richness.